VR chat, the next frontier. These are the experiences from Gunter's universe. His continuing mission, to seek out and connect with VR devs and passionate enthusiasts, to discuss theories, beliefs, and rhetoric of all kind, and to boldly go where no show has ever gone before.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Gunter's Universe. Yay!
Yeah.
Time to party.
Oh, yeah.
Hope everybody's doing well. Quickly, for those that are new, Gunter's Universe is a weekly VR talk show attended and recorded in VR chat. People from all over the world gather here every Tuesday at 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific, using their VR headsets to be a part of this awesome live experience. Anybody can join the show using their HTC Vive or an Oculus Rift, or you can just use your regular monitor. It's cool. Just go to VRChat.com to download the app, and it's free. And if you can't make it in to VRChat, that's cool, too. We have a stream going. It's twitch.tv/Gunter444. Cool. So that's the business. We have an awesome show lined up. Have an awesome guest tonight. Let me introduce her. Her name is Michelle Osorio, a.k.a. Michelle Kenobi. She's right here to my right. She does a whole bunch of things. She's a VR storyteller, as well as a filmmaker, a musician, a gamer, a YouTuber. She's the co-organizer at the Utah VR Meetup. She's in the Oculus Launchpad program. She's a creator at the YouTube Space in L.A. She runs the Metaversal or Virtual Storyteller Group. And she's also on Onalytics top 100 list of virtual reality influencers. Michelle, thank you so much for coming on the show. How are you?
I'm well. Thanks for asking. How are you? How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. Thanks for coming on the show, Michelle. It's great. It wasn't a few weeks ago, a month or so ago, that we were sitting next to each other in real life, drinking tequila shots, I believe.
I know. It was pretty weird meeting you in real life, and now it's weird to be here because, you know, it was a little bit less than a year ago that I tried my very, very first virtual reality demo at the Boston VR Meetup. It was at their June meetup, and then I think a month or two later, I came to watch your show, and I couldn't sit down. I couldn't figure out how to sit down, I remember.
Okay.
And so it's kind of surreal now to have met you in real life.
1 year later, yeah.
In another state, in Utah, and then to now be sitting in this chair. And I figured out how to sit down and everything.
Yes, for now. You might change. It's easy to pop out of these chairs. They're very slippery.
That's true. I might get really excited and have to jump up.
There's no jumping in the room, but we can, you know, pretend. Cool. Also with us is Bob, a.k.a. Cause and Effects. He's dinging and donging over there. How's it going, Bob?
Other than a little technical difficulties and a bee flying around in my room, I'm pretty good.
Bob, you tried to make it in with
a bee flying.
Yeah, there's a bee in my room.
Flying. They said a bee flying around.
There's flying around
a bee
too.
In my room.
Oh, this is awesome. So I'm glad your mic's always on then, so when you get stung, we can hear you cry like the 9-year-old person that you are when you get stung by bees. Actually, that's myself. cool. Awesome. And so, Michelle, you're in your dreamatorium right now.
Yes,
sir, I am. You built a dreamatorium. You built this awesome studio and place for you to get into VR and periscope it, and that's pretty sweet.
It is. It's actually dreamatorium 2.0. I built a whole... I took over the living room and then found out that my roommate was selling the house, and then I had to move, like, right after I built it. It was awesome. But that's okay. I built it again. Even bigger and better than ever. And it's a new place.
You sure do a lot. I feel pretty lame. Like I could barely roll out of bed, and here you are managing 10,000 projects. Hey! Did it happen?
Dude, did you get stung?
It's like crawling across the bottom of my monitor.
Oh my god. Just leave it alone.
Eat it.
The rule is you're supposed to step out of the room.
Die.
Don't step, whatever you do, don't step out of the room.
Harass right. it, it'll...
You know, bees are endangered, Bob. You're a monster.
Yeah, it's dead.
I don't think you're dead. Right.
Fatality. That's it, you'll find
I
out.
I think you can get it. It's a felony. Sorry. Alright. Okay. So, Bob, you got a little bit of news. If you can read it, go ahead. And then we'll get on to an interview with Michelle here.
Okay.
Good luck.
This is certainly an interesting show. Good evening. I'm Cause and Effect, bringing you the top headlines in VR news from this past week. Our top story this week. The first Google Daydream phone will be available on Thursday, online and in-store in China, from the phone manufacturer ZTE. The Axon 7 boasts a 5.5-inch, 538 ppi, 2560 by 1440 AMOLED display, a quad-core Snapdragon 820 processor running at 2.15 GHz, and USB 3.0 Type-C connector. Two models will be available with either 4 gigs of RAM and 64 gigs internal storage, or 6 gigs of RAM and 128 gigs of internal storage, and both are expandable via a micro SD card slot up to an additional 128 gigs.
Woohoo!
Pricing starts at $449 US. Tech Radar has had a hands-on with the ZTE VR headset. What looks like a Gear VR clone has 96 degree FOV and will reportedly be $79 in China.
Very, very cool. Oh, Michelle, we sometimes just let Bob keep reading the news, or we can jump in at any time, so feel free if you, something you hear just like, oh, I got an opinion about that. Jump right in.
Oh, okay.
In other news, last week, 360-degree video content and hardware creator Jaunt posted a press release on its website, which reads, CEO and co-founder Jens Christensen has decided to step aside, and the company has launched a search for a new chief executive officer to lead the company in its next significant growth phase.
I'll do it.
When you say step aside, what does that mean completely?
Not there anymore, right?
Still on the board?
Co-founder and chief technology officer Arthur Van Hoff will serve as interim CEO until a new CEO has been identified. And I'll just skip all the quotes and go to the next story so we can keep everything quick.
Cool. Sounds good.
Microsoft today announced its first software update to HoloLens. This includes running three apps at the same time, playing groove music in the background, being able to rotate your holograms, new voice commands to control holograms, adds tabs in Edge, and peek at their content, mixed reality photos, apps can be resized vertically, improved Bluetooth keyboard support, and support for Bluetooth mice.
Yay.
Oh, good update. Too.
During the Unite Europe 2016 keynote, Unity demoed its VR editor again, showing off new VR features, including being able to launch from the VR editor directly into play mode without the need to take the headset off. Also announced is that it will be available in Q4, and the code for their tools will be open sourced. They hope to see developers post extensions for the VR editor on its asset store.
Big praise to Unity. All of what you see in VR chat is thanks to Unity, so...
Amen.
Sounds awesome.
Praise be to Unity.
Yeah.
The Verge has reported that HP has announced its HP Omen X VR PC Pack hardware development kit prototype. The full specs haven't been published, but it's using the latest generation Intel processor, has hot swappable batteries that last an hour, and is targeted to come in at under 10 pounds. Pricing hasn't been announced, but it's expected to be available to developers in about a month.
Hot and swappable. Sexy.
So wait, it's under 10 pounds? That's fantastic for a laptop, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, yeah, whatever. 10 pounds for a laptop, that's not very good.
Well, it's going to be like DTR plus a backpack. I mean, DTR notebooks are heavy. Like, ones with full desktop graphics cards.
That's all fine and dandy, but can it hold juice packs?
Well, it's got two batteries that you can hot swap one at a time. So, I don't know. It doesn't say a juice pack? Oh, I don't know.
Like a Capri Sun?
Ecto Cooler, baby.
Juice boxes? Yeah, Ecto Cooler for the win.
All right, Bob, keep it going.
At its ComputerX 2016 booth, MSI has been showing off its VR backpack, working with an HTC Vive. The backpack runs an Intel i7 CPU, an NVIDIA GTX 980 graphics card, and a battery that lasts 1.5 hours. Like the other 3R backpacks announced by Zotac, Gigabyte, and HP, pricing has not yet been announced. And finally, the NVIDIA GTX 1080 Founders Edition is now available. And that's it for the news for this week.
Oh, that last story is a sweet one, right? I got the new Pascal technology or architecture. Not something I'm going to pick up immediately, but I'm glad it's there.
Yeah, I'd recommend people skip the Founders Edition and save money and just get one of the third-party aftermarket versions.
The one that fits into a pair of Ray-Bans.
Sure. All right, thank you, Bob, for the news.
Let's turn
our attention to our guest, Michelle. Michelle, it's time for me to ask you a bunch of questions because I actually have a lot of things I don't know about you. I actually don't know your background. I don't know your background. Where do you come from?
After we hung out that whole evening at the Utopia party and then we
not my fault.
Watered down alcohol experience together and we hung out with Cousin Tony.
Cousin Tony!
Cousin Tony! He's so famous.
He is. We talk a lot about him here, so people are... I think there's probably a few people that know what
we're talking
about.
Hashtag Cousin Tony.
We need to make an avatar of Cousin Tony.
Yes. That boy scanned.
I want to be him.
Yeah, so tell me about yourself. You know, people that don't know you, how did you... Before VR, what were you before VR?
Well, I've always been really creative, so I grew up drawing a lot. Everybody thought I was going to be an animator. But then The Little Mermaid came out when I was real small, and then I found out I could sing. So I ended up going to a performing arts academy in my teens, majoring in musical theater, and I thought I was going to be an actress. But then when I went to college, I realized I still have terrible stage fright. So it actually like really wears me out to perform on stage. So I realized I can't do this for a living. I would just be exhausted. So I still like to perform, but only once in a while because it takes a lot out of me because my heart is just racing the whole time, basically. But I've always been really creative. I went to film school at Southwestern Community College and never finished, but I took a ton of classes. And then I was actually a creative producer. Oh, I worked at SeaWorld. I was I started as a camera girl for the Shamu show and worked my way up to tape operator, then technical director. And that's the person that's calling the live shots, similar to kind of what happens here, right? So like a newsroom style directing. Mm-hmm. And then I also did the sound for the shows. And I have nightmares to this day. I've talked to other people who work there, and they said they have similar nightmares where I'm working at SeaWorld again all of a sudden, and they need me to do some new Shamu show, and I don't know how to do it. And I'm pushing buttons, and the music's not playing, and then Shamu jumps out of the tank and lands on the ground or crashes or lands on me or something crazy like that. This is off topic. Okay.
Where's SeaWorld? I live in Florida. Was it in Florida? Was there more SeaWorld out there that I'm aware of, like maybe in California?
SeaWorld, the one in San Diego. There's also one in Texas in San Antonio. Woo! I'm not sure what you said, but woo!
Yeah, same.
And then I ended ended up leaving SeaWorld to go work at DivX, not the Circuit City technology, but the video encoding company that named themselves after the failed Circuit City technology just to be obnoxious. So I worked for them for years. I was the creative producer, so I filmed tons and tons of silly, fun videos with all the employees there, and that was kind of my first taste of online video. I made a couple of series that went quote-unquote viral, but all of that doesn't exist anymore, so it doesn't mean much. But once in a while, people will tell me they still remember watching my first web series shut down way back in 2007, which I can't believe is almost 10 years ago. It's pretty crazy. Yeah. So I got really into online video. I considered myself a director for the longest time, a filmmaker. And then I got into YouTube. I made two really popular web series on YouTube, one called Boomer's Day Off, based on the game Left 4 Dead, and another one called The Real Sims, based on, obviously, The Sims. So I like to take video games I like to play, create live-action web series, multiple episodes, usually between 5 and 8 episodes, and build up characters that I make up and kind of give them a backstory and make it quirky and fun. That's kind of my jam. And through that, I got into YouTube Space LA's creator program. I got into their Geek Lab, and so since then, the last couple of years, I can shoot in their 44,000 square foot studio facility for free. Whenever I want. Now I have to pitch, but it's like Disneyland for filmmakers because we get access to jibs, cameras, lights, green screen. They have a sound stage where they change the set every season or so. So it's really a wonderful resource. They really support creators, and I'm forever grateful to them. But I got kind of burnt out on it. I moved to Boston because I was dating somebody there. And when you do YouTube, you can do whatever. You can live wherever you want.
Yeah.
And then I don't even remember why, but I went to the Boston VR Meetup, which hasn't become one of the top 5 VR meetups in the world, so it's a really big one. And I was just converted right away. I fell in love with it. And there's this dude named Amadeo Mapelli, and he is forever going to be in my story, forever, because he is the first person who ever showed me a VR demo, and it was something he had made called Symmetry, where you can build things yourself. So he told me, oh, you're a filmmaker? You could make a music video with this. And he showed me a music video he had made with flying butterflies, and you're floating through some beautiful pastoral landscape, and there's pretty music playing. So immediately, somebody told me, you could be a part of this. You could make something in VR. So I'll always be grateful to him for that. And then I couldn't sleep for 2 weeks thinking, what does this all mean? What does this mean? What is my place in this? Could I really learn how to do this stuff? I'm not a developer. I don't know how to make games. But by the next meetup, I had Velcroed together 2 action cameras and was making 360, really crappy, but making low-res 360 videos. And they asked me to demo it, and people were taking pictures of my rig and asking me a bunch of questions, and I kept saying, I don't know, I don't know what I'm doing. I literally just started a month ago. But that's when I realized how new all of this really was.
Yeah.
So as soon as I learned something, I was out there sharing it, and there wasn't a lot of information, especially then. A whole year ago, there wasn't much. So
it's true. It's changed. So landscape's totally different in one year. I mean, it's big now. It's everybody, not everybody knows, but like kind of does. A lot of my family I've never talked to about this are random people. They've heard of it. They see commercials now of VR. Crazy.
Right. Yeah, okay. Back then it was still a lot of tribal knowledge. So I was messaging people directly saying, how do you keep these cameras from overheating? What's the best setup? How can I get that stitch better? What's the best stitching software? And then I would try to share that with other people and convert other filmmakers or animators or visual effects people and get them into VR. So I'm happy to say I've converted at least 2 people from other industries over to VR, people who have since gone and made their own VR experiences. probably something I'm proud of, is getting other people into this.
Absolutely. That's my favorite thing with all the social VR stuff I do, is connecting dots and seeing people meet other people, or somebody getting a job based on somebody they met here on mm-hmm. Gunter's Universe. It's just like, yay. Or at a meetup, same thing. I love it. So you've done a lot of 360 videos. How many 360 videos do you think that you've made so far?
I probably made about 30, but I'm not happy with any of them, really. Yeah. I think there's two that I like. Most of them were just experiments, and if I could go back, I wouldn't have put them on my main YouTube channel. I thought, everybody's going to think this is so cool. And then all of my viewers were like, what is this? This is not Sims or video game stuff. It's just stupid 360 video. So I learned the hard way. You still have to fit your brand, and nobody seemed to care about these random little kind of... I went to San Diego Comic-Con and filmed cosplayers and SCA battles. And then I filmed one of the world's best accordionists of all time. I filmed a couple of little music jams with him. They just didn't fit my channel at all. But I have made two that I did like. I made a Sims-themed music video, and I made and I filmed myself trying Vico VR at VRLA, and I liked how those two came out. And but I've shot some stuff that's really cool that's coming out soon. I shot a prequel to Boomer's Day Off. So Boomer's Day Off is the story of the infected, which they're basically zombies of Left 4 Dead. It's a quirky little comedy about some of them. Mm-hmm. And I shot a prequel in 360, so you can find out the story of how they turned from humans into infected. And I got Earl Alexander, who is the voice of Lewis in Left 4 Dead, to be the voice of you from your point of view. So, but I shot it.
That went viral. It was like 25 billion views, I think. I think so.
Billion? Yeah, sure. Earl's a friend of mine now, and he was happy to be a part of it. But I shot with a new camera rig and found out I kind of didn't shoot it the best way possible. So even though I spent a day rehearsing, and it did, the stitch did come out okay, I'm a perfectionist, and once I started looking closely, I realized I should have shot a different way. So it took me a long time to get the stitch. And there's a couple of people from my Metaversal meetup, which is for creators who can meet in real life or wherever they want to meet. We can workshop and collaborate together. So I met two sound people who wanted to learn. They wanted to get into VR. So they're working with me to figure out how to do spatial audio for this project. So. That's why every time I think I'm almost done, there's another thing. So when I thought I was almost done, YouTube announced, "Hey, we got official audio now," and I'm like, "Dang it! One more thing I gotta learn."
Yeah, it's hard to stay on top of it all, but it's moving so fast. Like, this is the time to seize the moment.
It is.
I need to do better. I need to do better branding. Like, I can learn a lot from you and like Malia Probst. Women are just amazing. You Periscope before everything you do. I need to do that too. You got me on Snapchat. Snapchat's awesome. I'm snapping around.
Snapchat is a big deal. I know somebody. I probably shouldn't say where they work, but probably the VR company, who got sniped for Snapchat. But he didn't, and he changed his mind. But that's how I knew that they're looking for VR people for some reason. I don't know what they're doing.
Yeah, well, there's this great. One of the most recent Kent By Voices of VR podcast is with somebody that I can't remember her name, but is sort of a Snapchat expert, or she studies these things, and mm-hmm. she's talking about how Snapchat just bought an AR company. Don't remember the name of the company, so they're getting into the AR and VR, and it's pretty interesting, and mm-hmm. Just a whole hour-long talk about Snapchat chat that Kent did with her was pretty mind-blowing. There's too much to go in for this show, but really, Snapchat is really interesting for somebody that's 35. I never thought I'd be snapping anything.
Yeah. You start to get addicted to it, too. I'm Snapchatting everything. My roommate got mad because I was Snapchatting his cat having trouble pooping. Well, I didn't know it, but that's what was happening. He was just meowing a lot and like going around in circles, and the And I just thought it was funny, so I filmed it, and then suddenly he starts pooping while I'm filming the Snapchat. And my roommate got mad. But I didn't know that that's what was going on.
Postulating pooping pictures.
Okay, yeah, so if you follow me on Snapchat, you'll get all sorts of cool VR stuff. And then I make these little Snapchat musicals where I sing love songs, HTC vibes, and then random videos of cats pooping. So you get that beautiful trifecta.
And follow you on Periscope. Right before this, you did a Periscope about how you're going to be on Gunter's Universe. You were singing. I mean, so delightful.
No, I didn't actually get. I didn't get around to it. The Periscope. But I was doing it on Snapchat.
Or was it a Snap? It was a Snap.
It was
I'm
a
sorry.
Snap.
See
because
how
then
old
I
am.
Because then I tweeted a little compilation of my Snap. So you probably saw that and
okay.
thought that was.
I'm good. Still learning. I'm still learning.
That's all good.
Thank
there's
you.
Too many. There's too much stuff. There's too many places to.
Thank you, Michelle Kenobi. You're my only Snapchat hope. Okay. Terrible.
Okay, I forgive you.
More things that you're involved in. I'm going to go through some of the things that we've mentioned in kind of more detail, like the creator at YouTube Space LA. Like, how do you become part of that? When did that start?
I'm not sure. I think it was 2012, maybe late 2012, because I joined in mid-2013. So I was with a network at the time. I don't know. You know how there are YouTube multi-channel networks.
Yeah.
They're kind of like, almost like agents in a way. They're supposed to get you better revenue, better deals, a lot of things that they promise that a lot of them don't actually do. But I was part of a pretty good one called Fullscreen, and my rep messaged me and said, hey, did you know YouTube is looking for a geek-themed YouTube channel to add to their roster of creators at the space? You should apply. And I was actually camping or something. I was really not in a position to shoot an application video, but I just did one anyway at the top of a mountain. Or not a mountain. That sounds so fancy. On top of a big hill. I don't know. Or a very small mountain. I don't know. It ended up being a pretty shot, but we didn't really have everything we needed. And it was super windy. So my friend took his sock off and put a sock on the microphone, just like totally gorilla, and just shot something. And sent it, and I couldn't edit it. I just said, hey, look at stuff on my channel. If you think it works, YouTube, then pick me. And they picked me. So I got into Geek Lab. And that is pretty much how YouTube has been slowly adding more and more creators. They might not be doing, I think they still do labs, but now they have lots of creators kind of fighting for resources, so it's not quite the same. But at that time, it was a lot emptier at YouTube Space because they wanted to make sure they were picking the right people who fit certain genres. Like there was a music lab, there was a comedy lab, I was in the geek lab. And then they make you, I had to make 8 videos in 2 months. I had to attend a ton of workshops. And then once I was done, I got into what's called the alumni program. And then I can go to other workshops. And sometimes I have to go to the workshop in order to access new equipment. So I had to do that in order to operate a jib, for instance. I had to take a RED workshop to use the 4K RED cameras. And then recently I took a 360, even though I already knew how to do it, but I took a 360 camera workshop so that I could access all of their 360 cameras that they have there now.
Nice. I love that.
Oh, so the way you get in is, at the time, I believe this is still the case, you have to have a minimum of 10,000 subscribers. And then at that point, I think there's 3 different ways you can get in. I think you can try to get a residency, although you usually have to have 100,000 for that. You can apply for one of their labs, or if there's no lab coming up that fits your channel, you can just pitch something to them, a one-off idea where you just say, hey, I really need your green screen for this. Or I heard you have an airplane set, and I really need it for this. Here's my pitch. And I'm going to work with, you know, these 3 other YouTubers, and we're going to work together. They really like if you collaborate as well, so that kind of helps, too. So that's how you get access to that space. Oh, and news, brand new news, just from this afternoon. It took a few weeks to solidify this, but I'm going to be hosting a VR meetup at YouTube Space in July.
Hey, that's awesome. Congratulations.
Yeah. Thanks.
Right on.
That's great. So what's your plan there? Like, what does that exactly mean?
It will most likely be July 19th. That we were talking about the 20th, but that's the beginning of San Diego Comic Con.
July 19th is my birthday.
Is it? Oh. Well, there we go. So basically, I got invited to this VR symposium at YouTube Space. It was really cool. There weren't a ton of YouTubers there. They specifically only looked for narrative storyteller YouTubers. They paired us up with Sundance filmmakers. It was really a weird kind of combination. And then the Sundance Institute came and got all of these people from ILM, from Verse, from Penrose Studios. I don't remember if they got Unity or not, but just a ton of people to come and talk to us for 2 days. We did workshops. We filmed stuff on the cameras. And it was just about storytelling. And there was actually a lot of heated arguments about how things should be done, because, of course, we're still figuring this out. But YouTube was trying to get that ball rolling. But other than that one-time event and then these occasional 360 workshops that you do to get certified to check out equipment, other than that, there haven't been any VR events. So I pitched this idea to YouTube Space, and I said, hey, I'm a filmmaker, but and I'm a YouTuber. But I constantly feel like those two worlds never collide with VR. And every time I go to a VR meetup, it's a whole different group of people. That's all enthusiasts and developers. And we need those worlds to collide. We need these people to commingle, because YouTubers need to understand the importance of VR. And if they try it, they might be more interested in making 360 content or VR content that also works as 360 content, which is, I think, is better. And more forward-looking. But I think that VR symposium, which was just a month or two ago, that was significant to me, because to me that was the first time in a whole year that YouTube really finally was saying, okay, we really, really, really are getting behind VR for realsies now, and kind of syncing up with Google, who we know supports VR. But they're finally getting organized enough to support creators and get them into VR. And it took a little bit of pitching or lobbying, because the 360 programmer at YouTube and the events lady, they know that 360 is important, but they wanted to know, why did I need to do a VR meetup where people can demo VR stuff? They just wanted to do 360 video stuff. And I said, the problem is, if you do a 360 video event, a lot of YouTubers aren't going to care, because they're not going to understand why that's important. But if you can show them other stuff, like the Vive, they have a Vive room there now. And I heard they just opened it up to people to be able to use. If you can show people Vive, and you can show people things like Symmetry, which is what I tried, and you can show them a bunch of games, and you can introduce them to new technologies like 8i, which is doing live-action 3D scanning. Now you can open up the minds of very creative people and let them run with it, and let them kind of help be a part of that, to help shape that future of what media is going to be. That wouldn't have happened for me if I had just learned about 360 video. I'm not sure if I would have even cared if that was the first thing I learned. Or I might not have shown up to the workshop. I probably would, but some people won't. I know some YouTubers who don't care about 360 video. But those worlds are going to collide eventually when we have light fields. And we can actually record, or even 8i with the 3D scanning. One day, you can be a live-action filmmaker and be doing VR. Right now, 360 video and VR are kind of two separate worlds, but they will come together. And I think YouTube and Google have finally come together, and they see that. And they're going to need creators to help build that future. I think that's what that VR symposium was all about, was getting people on board with that, even though it's very, very new.
It's exciting to hear. You know, within this last year, that's what we've seen, is Google getting on board heavily.
Yeah.
You know, there's recent announcements with Daydream, and it's great to hear that YouTube's doing this. Cool. Tell me, moving on to another thing that you're involved in, the Oculus Launchpad. What is the Oculus Launchpad?
So I applied for Oculus Launchpad 2 minutes after the deadline. I don't remember where I was, GDC or somewhere. I was traveling. And once again, just like the YouTube Space program, I thought, I'm not going to get into this. This is way over
Right.
This is way out of my pay grade, but I gave it a shot anyway. And I said, hey, I'm not a filmmaker. I mean, sorry, I'm not a developer. I'm a filmmaker, but I have these cool ideas. Here's what I'd like to do. And I got picked for that, too. So Oculus Launchpad, they're trying to promote diversity, but I don't think it's entirely diversity in terms of just people of color and women, because I saw not that also at Oculus Launchpad. I think that they also just wanted a diversity of ideas outside of the existing entertainment and gaming industry. So I saw a lot of educators there. I saw a lot of artists. I saw people who are working for social causes, people who want to teach homeless women how to code, and this guy who works with kids with autism and had this idea for an app that teaches kids with autism how to behave in a bullying scenario. So these people just have really cool ideas that are really out of the box. And I think that's exactly what Launchpad was going for, was, okay, what are people who don't work in games and in Hollywood, what would they do with VR if they had the right resources? So what I pitched is something I shot last year at YouTube Space. I kind of did this experiment. I got an email from YouTube Space, and they said, hey, we have a day slot opening up in our horror film set. And a day slot is very coveted at the YouTube Space. So they said, do you have any ideas? By the way, like, you have to be ready to shoot it like in a week. So it was very hectic. But I had been playing with this idea for a sci-fi project I really wanted to do. So suddenly I had like 4 days to get all of this together. So I had to write a script. I had to gather a crew. I had to cast it. I gathered all the 360 filmmakers I knew from Facebook and said, hey, you want to go see the YouTube Space? And we kind of knew what we were doing, but I told them, hey, we have the space for free. The only thing this is costing me is a couple $100 for like the makeup and the food. So let's use this opportunity to workshop. Don't see me as a director. See me as kind of an overseer, but I want to know your ideas. And we workshopped how to shoot this idea I had and this really weird, bizarre, convoluted meta type script. And I would say some of it was not successful. Some of it didn't, when you watch the 360 video back, it doesn't make sense. Some of it does. That's kind of where we are right now. But I'm really glad I did it, because I was able to take that footage of what I shot and show that in my application to Launchpad and say, here's a proof of concept of something I want to do. This stuff worked, this stuff didn't work. I want to do more. If somebody can help me make it happen, not just with funds, but I needed mentorship, because I want to make it interactive. I have ideas of taking 360 video and making it interactive so that you can change what video plays depending on where you're looking. And if anybody knows how to do that, please contact me. I'm Michelle Kenobi on Twitter. I know there's some startups working on it, but they're all flying under the radar somewhat and have told me they can't let me touch their stuff yet. But that's what I want to do. I have a really epic sci-fi series idea called Ion Agent, and the story can continue even when we get to 3D scanning. I have talked to 8i, and I'm hoping maybe they'll let me shoot something there next year so I can have 3D live action models. And then after that, one day when we have light fields, the story still works. I built the engine of this story to work even as the technology changes for VR storytelling. But it is a sci-fi mystery that takes place inside VR. So you are a person in VR in the future.
Great.
But you can you're using a special program to travel back through people's memories to uncover a mystery of what happened to your parents.
So cool.
Love it. That's awesome. Yeah, exactly. Cool. Can't wait to check that out and keep learning more about development. Storyboarding with Tilt Rush. Saw something about that on your Twitter. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I wish I could credit the person that gave me the idea, but I don't remember who it was. It was someone at Launchpad. Because filmmakers have been talking for a while about what is the best way to storyboard a 360 video or anything like that. And somebody at Oculus Launchpad said, tilt brush, duh. And I had not really thought about it until that moment. I thought, oh, yeah, duh. So I'm working with Will. I don't know if Will is here. He goes by Crudger. Will?
Well, Sunday.
He's a co-founder of Utah.
Hello.
He's back here. A little floating Metroid. It's hard to tell.
Oh, yeah. You're always the floating Metroid. That's it. So we were having a really, we do this all the time, very long, animated, excited conversations about what we want to see in VR. And I told him, I hate menus. So I told him, I want to make a player for my videos and my experiences that has like almost no words and almost no buttons. I wanted to make I grew up by Disneyland, so I spent many years at Disneyland, which is what I consider like the best theme park experience. And it took going to the Void and talking to them for 8 hours while shooting a documentary to realize that they're on the right track. They're looking at VR from a theme park perspective. Mm-hmm. And I thought, that's what I want to do. I want to make a world. I want to make this world a story world that you're in. And instead of hitting some buttons to play some video I made or to experience some game I made, you can walk or fly or teleport through my player world. And that's how you can pick out things that you want to experience. So, but I was having a hard time expressing this to Will and realized Tilt Brush was a really good way to do that. Because then I can kind of draw what you're seeing. Okay, you wake up and there's this statue and there's a path that goes over there and there's the bushes and then way off in the distance you see this building off there. And you can draw it so that people can understand what you're talking about. But you can do it in all directions.
Yeah. Oh, sweet. I love that. I love seeing people using Tilt Brush for interesting things. You know, either great pieces of art or prototyping. Or we have a user, Circuitry, here who just simply went in Tilt Brush and kind of traced his body and exported it and brought it into VR Chat, and that was his first avatar.
That's such a good idea. I didn't think about that.
I don't know the process, but you know, we can certainly find out if anybody's interested in that. Join our community here. We'll make that happen too.
I saw one use on Twitter that was for a wedding. The guest book that you can sign was in Tilt Brush.
What? Oh, that's awesome!
Oh, that's really
smart. Oh, that's nice.
Love that. The Void.
The Void.
We were all at the Void, same
infinite
time.
Dimension.
Hyper-reality.
Hashtag hyper-reality, y'all. Not the y'all.
So, me and Bob went to the Void, went to Utah, went to the meetup, 300 people there, hung out with Michelle and Chris Madsen, who's also a deep rifter, and Vishnu, and blah, 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 a whole bunch of people. I'm not going to carry on too much, but...
Cousin Tony!
But yeah, me and Bob, one of the reasons we came to Utah was to try the Void, and then we were on our way to Silicon Valley for the SVVR meetup. And Michelle, you were there. You did a little filming and interviewing of our experience. That was really cool. And that wasn't your first time to the Void. This was the return to the Void, the return of the Void, or something like that. Tell me, first time you tried the Void, or... Yeah, there is some people breathing into their microphones, so if you can... Or try to find you.
Conchu.
Who is it? Conchu. It's you, Conchu. I'm so sorry. Just toggle that mic off, and everything will be good, and it happens to everybody, so it's not a big deal. But if you could, I don't know, either toggle it off or go back into the settings and remove mic always on. Yeah, tell us about the Void. Thank you.
The Void is awesome. So the Void seemed so magical when I first heard about it, and I really didn't think I would end up living in Utah, in Salt Lake City, where I'm going to be for a while. And what happened? Oh, I remember. I was looking around in the 360 Facebook, 360 and VR professionals Facebook group, and somebody posted and said, is anybody going to be in Salt Lake City on such and such date who has 360 cameras and knows how to film with them, but no GoPros? Exclamation point.
No GoPro.
For some reason. So I messaged this guy and said, hey, I just got the new Kodak SP360 dual mount 4K setup. I shot a little bit at Sundance. It looked fine, but I haven't had a lot of time to play around with it. But it's not GoPro. So we talked a little bit, and he ended up bringing me on as a co-producer for a documentary that he was making for a TV network in France. So they were making a documentary. Well, they're making a short documentary, but in addition, he wanted to do a supplemental 360 documentary. So he said, hey, you can be the co-producer of this and come and shoot if you have time to hang out at the Void all day on Monday. And I'm like, let me check my schedule. Sure, why not? I think I can make time for this.
Yeah.
So it was really cool. Not only did I get to try the Void, what was really interesting is before I could even try it, I got to do something a lot of people don't get to do, which is I got to walk around in the stage. I think you saw the outside of it, Gunter.
The
one that's permanent. So that, because they were working on it, so he only got to see outside of it, if at all. So what was neat is we got to really spend a lot of time in there with bright lights, and we followed around the subjects of the documentary as they went through the Void. So I got to see it complete, glaring, not real, foam walls, people acting silly. So I really got to see the non-magical side. And yet, it still didn't matter. When I went in with my headset, I was there. It was completely immersive. Unfortunately, there were some glitch problems when I tried it, because all of the good gear had just been shipped off TED. So I was getting the janky, like, backup, old, used stuff. So there were a couple of times where it was glitching, and my keeper, as I called her, said, you know, we can just stop if you want. It's been making you sick. And I was like, no, I will finish this. And so once in a while, it would just turn into noise. Right. And I would just stop until it would reconnect. And then I would keep walking. And it was weird because there's this disembodied voice going, come this way, Michelle. And I'm like trying to make my way through the journey because I just really wanted to finish it. But, I mean, it was fantastic. But I would say it was more my experience after that. It was getting to spend 8 hours there with the people who are working on it, interviewing the founders, and understanding all the work that's going into it. And so many people are dedicating, you know, 40 hours, I don't know, 50 hours a week on this. And I think that's why it's so amazing, whether it's 3D artists or developers, people who used to work at theme parks. A couple of people worked at theme parks. I guess they pitched this to the Void and they said, hey, you need us. You need our input. We could add a lot. And the Void said, yeah, sure, come on down. So it's amazing what a group of people can do when they put their mind to it and they all have one vision. There's a sculptor, too, a guy who's just making sculptures for things that you can touch, but also decorations for the actual place when they build it in real life, to make it feel real. And they have a story guy. I forgot his name, but he's the founder's father, who's like a sci-fi writer.
Tracy Hickman.
And he's creating this whole lore. That was my favorite part. That's what got me thinking, man, I should read the biography of Disney, because I think the story of Disney and Disneyland, that's where I think, as a storyteller, I could probably get a lot of ideas from. Because that's what they're doing with the Void. All 8 experiences that they're going to have, they exist in that same universe, or in that canon. It's hard to say universe, story universe, I guess you could say, because they are jumping through dimensions. But all 8 of those exist in the same storyline.
Yeah, and so that's what you do. You have a character, an avatar. As you revisit the Void, you continue to, I don't know if you're going to level up, but your achievements, the things that you find, and there will be secrets based on how much of the lore you've been consuming or reading, and there'll be, you know, things to do offline, you know, to either read or participate via mobile apps or something, some other things, but really creating this giant story behind it all. Each experience that you go through, you're now stepping through the portal to whatever universe or whatever dimension that is to have your experience, but it's your character goes through that and then comes back and then it keeps going through the other dimensions, stuff like that. It's really cool. I still want to know more and get more of the pieces of their vision, but man, they're involved in, you know, stories, the technical stuff, the tracking hardware, the Rapture headsets. They're involved in real estate. They're building this giant facility out there in Salt Lake City. I was lucky enough to see the blueprints, and boy, man, is that a massive facility. And just, you know, I met James Jensen, the chief visionary officer, which is so appropriate. And Chris Deeprifter describes him as like the Willy Wonka of this the warehouse. You know, I can only imagine when it's this whole facility.
But nicer.
Oh, yeah. He doesn't have, not a dick. Totally not a dick. But he came on the show. He was around this table. It's just, it's so cool. Got to interview him about 9 months ago. And then, it was a couple months ago. I was like, hey, I want to be out in Utah. Can I try the Void? And he was like, yes, of course. And, I don't know, the rest of it's history. And the next step is their newest attraction, which is with this great IP called, I don't know, you may have heard of it, Ghostbusters. Yep, that's their next experience coming out in New York City in Times, I don't know if it's Times Square, but somewhere around there.
Yep, at Madame Tussauds Times Square. I'm going to be there opening day, 9 a.m., July 1st.
That's awesome. I might be going too, but I'm not sure yet. It's awesome. I'm jelly!
Too.
So excited!
Can't swing that.
And don't forget China.
Oh, I don't think I knew. Is it released? Maybe...
Well, I'm saying that there's going to be one in China, too. The Void, cool. I mean.
Yeah. Sweet. I wonder what experience that's going to be.
I hope it is an identical experience, because I think what would be awesome is if you can interact with people in a duplicate space in China.
And that's part of their plans is to, not only is, like, me and Bob went through the Void together, so I could see, you know, an avatar, his hands
and
moving.
And I could steal his light so he couldn't see.
All kinds of cool stuff. You stole the torch, and I'm like, Bob, wait a minute. There's only one torch, and I was following Bob. I can't see. But yeah, the idea is...
I kept forgetting and leaving Gunner behind.
Two torches probably would have been nice. But sticking together and being a team, and I think they're going to be four people in a pod when these come out. And then eventually you're going to be able to play against other people in other Void centers. Even with people at home that are on, like, the app or whatever it is, like, you might be able to be zombies, let's say, in a zombie experience that somebody might be going through. And, you know, so these zombies coming at you are not controlled by just artificial intelligence, but by real people. And I think that's super cool, super ambitious. Yeah.
I keep hitting myself in the face, in the visor. What, I don't remember if this was the documentary or this was, you were there, but I don't remember if I'm, let's say it. Never mind.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
I don't know what I'm saying.
Yeah, there's some stuff that's like, am I supposed to talk about this?
AI, like, magic. Let's just say that.
I have the same thing. I basically don't talk about a lot of it. Just I didn't have to sign anything, but, you know, it's cool, man. I don't want to be.
Gunther's
I don't know.
Universe.
If I wanted to talk about it, I would just ask them if I could talk about it. Anyway, it's super cool. So,
secret, yes.
I get all of them. Give them to me. They're under your seats, and only five people can grab them. Okay.
We got some killer swag
awesome.
Too.
Damn.
Oh, I've
something
to say
World
about
of
that.
Warcraft?
Of course.
Look, I'm making bread.
I love it. You're crafting right now. While you're on
yeah,
the show.
Or I'm leatherworking.
Yeah.
Basically the same thing.
Bob was saying that we got some nice Void swag, you know. It was really nice to get t-shirts and hats. Now the only problem,
that's awesome.
I was like, oh, I want this, I want this Void t-shirt because of the artwork. I really like that it says Void. Blah, blah. Turns out, guess what? It's a V-neck. Oh, here you go, wife. Here you go, wife. So, no Void t-shirt for me to wear.
You have a hard life.
You can pull off a V-neck, Gunter. I believe in you.
No, come on, it's this huge beard. It's so weird. Come on. I'll put it on, take a picture, and then let you
You'll just have to grow your beard longer and then have it, you know,
yeah,
cover it up.
It does almost cover it all, but there's still, I still know.
Just wear a snazzy ascot. Ascot. Like, right there.
I'm not going to do that either. And plus, my wife knows, and she won't let me. So, you know, she's embarrassed of the V-neck. This guy should not be wearing a V-neck. This is, like, really bad idea. Oh, what else? Metaversal VR Storytellers Group. Tell us about that, Michelle.
So I had started a meetup group when I was in Boston. It was for YouTubers, actually, because there was nothing for new media people. There was a filmmaker group, and that was it. It ended up getting a lot of members, I think because there was just a void, that needed to be filled. And But we ended up talking a lot about 360 video and VR. And it actually wasn't until I came to Salt Lake. And there's a ton of YouTubers here, so there was no need to start a meetup. I thought, oh, I'm good. But then I realized there was no place for creatives to meet and just talk about making stuff in VR or on YouTube, you know, any of that new kind of stuff. Once again, there was a filmmaker group and a VR group, but not a place for creative people to come and workshop or collaborate, for musicians to look for developers or directors to look for actors, so on and so forth. So I decided, what if I make a group, but I make it a sister group to the Boston group, and then just keep trying to grow it, because there's not enough of that, enough real-life meetups like that yet. So I decided to call it Metaversal, because that was the original name of my 360 series when I was playing around and making all those 360 videos. So once I realized I can't keep doing that on my YouTube channel, they need to be stories that fit my brand, I'm like, well, it's such a good name. I still want to do something with it. So I said, let's call the meetup that. So there's a meetup group in Salt Lake, and then there's a meetup, a Metaversal meetup group in Boston, and then I'm hoping to have one in California, Southern California eventually as well. So hopefully I can partner it with that YouTube VR event, so that can technically be the first Metaversal meetup there. I hope that's the goal. But the idea was just to have a place on Meetup in real life, in VR, and on Facebook, where people can just share ideas who are specifically trying to learn and how to tell stories in VR or in new media. People who are just playing with brand new technologies, or maybe it's not as easy. You can't go to school for it. That kind of thing, you know, you have to just go out there and do it and just give support to those people. So I've done a couple of meetups ago. I did one about, here's how you make a 360 video. And I told all the YouTuber group people, too. I said, here, if you don't know how to do it, I'm going to bring a couple of rigs, and we're just going to do it for 3 hours. We're going to decide what we're going to shoot. We're going to go out and shoot it. We're going to put it in a computer. We're going to stitch it. We're going to sideload it. And we're going to put it on YouTube, and then we're going to watch it back on Gear VR and on Cardboard, and that's what we did. The goal being to show people, look, this isn't that hard. It's not that scary. Here's exactly how you do it. And that's what the meetup's all about, is to try to make that stuff more accessible to people, because it can be very intimidating.
You
can look for Metaversal Virtual Storytellers on Facebook or on meetup.com. And my goal is to eventually integrate it with VR. I'm not sure how I'm going to do it yet, but I would like to, when we have a meeting in real life, that people can also join in VR somehow. I just have to figure out the best way to do that so that people can come even if they can't physically be there.
It's a challenge. Like, this is what I've thought about a lot. Like, I always wanted a meetup where people from anywhere could attend, because I'm in South Florida, but I'm not by Miami. I'm not by anywhere there's going to be a VR meetup, so there was that. I knew there's a lot of people in this sort of situation. But it can be challenging to tie the real-life meetup with the virtual one, certainly.
It is, yeah.
You know,
I think AR will really help with that. I'm really becoming more and more a believer in, not that I didn't believe it before, but now that I've gotten to play a lot more with HoloLens and the Metas, and I've been playing Ingress because I'm trying to prepare for Pokemon Go. And I'm starting to kind of be able to envision it better. AR will solve a lot of problems that are harder to do in VR. VR, it will teleport you, you know, to wonderful places you couldn't be in real life. But I'm excited when we can take a HoloLens or a Meta and project our avatars and people who are, yeah, somewhere else in Florida or in the Mojave Desert, doesn't matter where they are, they can be there in that space with you without you having to lose sight of the real life environment that you're in.
Cool. So let's talk about social VR then. So we were just talking about how to connect your real life meetups in the social VR space. You've traveled around a lot of the social VR applications. We've seen each other in various social VR applications. What do you think of social VR? This is a shit, right?
Man, I love social VR. How do I say this? It's so hard to put this into words. When I was a teenager, and I was really into the early internet days, I was running around in Cybertown. I think that's what it was called? Cybertown? Cyberworld?
Cybertown?
I don't know. I don't know. It was so ahead of its time.
Awesome.
It was like a Second Life, but so not ready for that.
I've actually heard of that, yeah.
So, yeah, like, I don't know. When I first tried VR and I couldn't sleep for those 2 weeks, I kept thinking of those first experiences I had where trying to connect worlds with other people using the internet and how it wasn't quite there yet, but we're getting there now. And what does that all mean, and how can I be a part of it? And I'm starting to, it's weird. It just feels like, I feel like a kid again in a really bizarre deja vu way. Not like dreams come true kind of way. It's hard to explain. It feels like deja vu. And it's weird. But it's exciting. It's what I wanted when I was a teenager, to be able, a socially awkward, Star Wars loving musical theater nerd who didn't have like a lot of nerdy friends but really wanted to connect with people, you know, across the intertube. And now we're getting there, and I'm really excited. So I'm excited about live streaming 360 video because that's one of the first things I imagined when I discovered the current iteration of VR, because I thought, now I will always have friends. That sounds so sad. I have friends, but I can be friends to people who want friends as well. Because as you know what it is, YouTube really taught me how to connect with people on the internet better. I think a lot of kids are always messaging me and interacting with me when I live stream. And I thought, how cool will it be? Because a lot of adults don't get YouTube, they put down people like PewDiePie, and they say they don't get Minecraft, which is fine. Minecraft is its own beast, but the thing is, they don't get is it's this need for connection with people who are just like you and like things that you like, and it's hard to find. Sometimes that's hard to find if you don't expand your pool through technology. And so the reason why YouTubers, I'm not this way, but the reason why some YouTubers are like, hey guys, don't forget to like and subscribe, and they're super loud and obnoxious, is because they're trying to shout out and get attention from kids who are, or anybody who's watching this tiny screen on their mobile phone. Half of YouTube viewers are on their mobile phone. And right, so you're trying to get people's attention when you're competing with the real world and tons of saturation of other media. And when you ask kids, like, why do they like watching people play games? Or, you know, why do they like a PewDiePie or whoever it is they like? They say, I feel like they're my friend. Or I feel like I know them. And it's like them coming to visit me every day or us hanging out every day. So what I tell people is, what 360 live streaming video or social VR, which will one day kind of, I think, combine, but we're not there yet. I'm telling people that concept, the YouTube concept, to the next level. Take that thing a lot of adults barely understand, multiply that by 100, because now it's not a tiny version of a YouTuber coming to a kid's house. Now it's all of those viewers are coming to your house.
Look at this.
Yeah.
Look at all these people that just came out to watch our show here. There's like 30 of them, and that's what I loved. Yeah.
Beautiful.
I want to be with my audience. Yeah, exactly.
So that's what I want to do. And maybe 360 live streaming will get there. You know, that's what I want. I want to be able to watch and be like, hey, come over, watch us do this writing session, and we're working on this thing. Come on over and see what we're doing.
That's all the raw sort of videos and information, how people are putting themselves out there in a raw style instead of this super curated style, because you feel like you can understand them more, relate to them more. This is like the future is how, you know, I've had enough stuff marketed to me or crap from the past.
Yes.
Like, I want to know the people. People
exactly.
are what matter in the end.
Yeah. And I think that's why I had a hard time, because I've been on YouTube a long time, but I was always behind the camera.
Hold on one second.
Felt...
Look over there. Oh, he just stopped. Sorry. Yeah,
what?
No, behind
no,
you.
No, that me? Oh, what?
ER Commando?
Yes, he's freaking
having
out
a poltergeist moment?
Yes.
Oh. Or not poltergeist, exorcist moment. That's what it
exorcist. Something. He's being possessed.
The power of Christ compels you. Well, that didn't work.
No.
I tried.
But yeah, it's about people. Yeah, and all the new, you know, raw stuff. So.
Oh, I remember. I was gonna say that's why I had a hard time. But I've learned how to do it. It took me a few years, but I've learned how to put myself out there and be in front of the camera, because I realized. Somebody told me, my cinematographer said, you're the brand, Michelle, don't you get it? Like, it's not Kill on TV, it's you. You need to start being in front of the camera. And it took a long time to get comfortable with that, because I felt weird. I felt, like, narcissistic and full of myself. And I still feel weird making all these Snapchat selfies, but it feels good, like, to be expressive. But why I really love the thought of 360 video and VR and bringing people into your world is, now you don't have to be, don't forget to like and subscribe. You can just be yourself and just calm the heck down and just be you. And so I'm excited that I can just be me without, it's the same thing as that stage fright, that musical theater thing I talked about. Like, it's too much to put myself out there and be larger than life all the time. I like the idea of people just like who I really am, then they'll come, and if not, then they won't. And I don't have to try to vie for people's attention. I just love that idea that you can just be real. And that's how I direct people in 360 videos. People have a really hard time with that. And I tell them, like, just be how you would be in real life. Like, don't spin it. Just be yourself. Just calm down.
That's awesome.
Well, that's inspiration to me. I'm still struggling with putting more of myself. I think that's why I'm an avatar most of the time or something. Or, you know, I'm half introvert, half extrovert, so it depends on, like, my mood of where I'm, you know, kind of feeling. So when I started getting into, like, starting a meetup, it was for me, too, of, like, I'm going to put myself in front of these people, I'm going to do it weekly, I'm going to talk to people that have an intelligence level way up there, interact with them, you know, and came out of a shell, even though you wouldn't think that somebody that hosts a talk show and talks too much and rambles would be that way, but I am. I struggle with it. So social VR has helped me tremendously through the meetups and then through doing a talk show. And then now I'm very comfortable, and then I go out to the real meetups and conferences and have lots more confidence. There's still that guy inside that's very shy and scared too, but gaining lots of confidence through all this.
Yeah, I think that shyness never really goes away. People always say they're surprised when I tell them I'm shy or I'm anti-social sometimes and I just need to hide in a room for many hours after a party, but you just learn how to work with that person and to show them that people aren't going to laugh at you. Well, maybe they will, I don't know, but you're probably going to be
you're
all right.
Being
you're
being you,
probably,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm sure somebody's laughing at me right now.
It's me!
Haha! Oh, shit, the mic's on.
Gunter sucks! What was that? Questions. Anybody has questions, feel free
I got a couple.
Yep, please.
So, you've worked with a lot of different equipment for 360-degree cameras. I know you have, like, kind of a large collection. What's your current, like, favorite camera to shoot with for 360 right now?
I still really like my Kodak SP360 4K dual mount because it's only two cameras, so you only have to stitch two, and you can get really close to the camera. because it's got this big fisheye. I had problems with other rigs where there were things you could not do. People could not get close to the camera, which is a real big problem for me, because that's one of the biggest draws of VR is that intimacy. Having said that, it's kind of a weird time, and I knew this was going to be a risk going in as an early adopter. I knew that all my stuff was going to be obsolete within months, yeah. And so I've cycled through camera rigs every 3 to 6 months, and that's been painful. But we're right on the cusp, you know, the 365, the Gear 360. I'm super excited that we're right there. We're stitching, and I knew this would happen. You know, stitching would become a thing of the past. And like many things in VR, it happened sooner than I thought. Every time you make an estimate, this will be possible in 5 years. It's possible in 3 years. If it's possible in 2 years, it's possible in what it's really going to happen in 1 year, and that's what's happened. So I'm so excited for that because I hate stitching video so bad, especially because I'm a perfectionist. So I'm sitting there with on a widescreen TV, like a giant TV, and I'm like 6 inches from the screen trying to stitch like all these little lines because I don't want to break the immersion. And I have a lot of times where I want to throw something through the window because I tell myself, I'm a storyteller. What am I doing? Why am I sitting here cleaning up stuff for hours and hours, yeah. And it's soul sucking? So I'm so happy it's almost over. And it's the reason why I didn't get certified in Stitch. I won't name the software because I don't wanna, I'm not bad-mouthing them or anything. But I knew that this was going away. And one thing I forgot to mention was, when I went to this VR symposium at YouTube Space, and YouTube and Google said, hey, we are here to support you, one of the things they promised was they said in a couple of months, so now I think that's a month from now, they said, you're going to have access to that Jump technology, the Jump assembler. Mm-hmm. That's the thing I have been dreaming of for a year, and they promised this a year ago. They promised this last summer, so... I'm super excited. So it's that, I don't know if it's the GoPro Odyssey or not, but it's something like that one. It's a 16 camera rig. They're going to have two of them. We can check them out for free to shoot stuff with. But and the thing that's really huge about that is I don't care how many cameras it is. What I care about is it's 3D, and that has been the bane of live-action 360 filmmakers' existence for the last 2 years. It's 3D, but more importantly, the Jump algorithm is going to use machine learning to simulate, you know, what a human understands of what is close, what is far, and it's going to do it all itself. So from what I've been told, and some people who are writing the manual for it told me it really works, you hit record, shoot the world, you hit stop, you upload that footage to the cloud, and you come back the next day, and it's all supposedly stitched in 3D. The 3D part is the kicker, because that is a very expensive process right now. Most people have to hire 3D artists at about $600 to $1,000 a day to fix this stuff right now, if you're trying to do 3D. Uh-oh. So that's a huge deal. I almost considered moving across the street from YouTube Space. I started looking at apartments, just because I knew I would be able to touch that camera and that assembler, except I found out then it was like $1,200 to rent one room in a house. So I said, never mind.
Oh, wait, yeah.
But still, I'm going to be there a lot. Yeah. But that's such a huge deal. I mean, I'm so excited because access to that means so much to me, because right now, to shoot 3D is so expensive. That is the reason why you're not seeing a lot of 3D content out there right now in live action, because only Hollywood studios or, Patron Tequila can afford the budget for it. So we're almost there, guys. We're almost there.
So my other question was, have you experimented with or plan to experiment with the kind of, like, new mixed reality where you're kind of using green screens or using a HoloLens to record stuff?
Yes. I'm trying to decide. I've been debating whether I should paint my walls a pretty picture or a pretty color like Nathie the YouTuber does, or do I want to just set up a green screen? And I'm juggling so many things. I decided I'm going to wait till other people really get it down well, and then I'll jump into the mixed reality if it's easy enough to do. And only because I'm trying to do so much, and I keep getting distracted with the live streaming, and I do have a second channel. That's the Michelle Kenobi channel, and I'm going to be doing a lot more live streaming, trying VR games, app experiences. I do want to have that second place to play around, but I don't want to spend so much time on it that I'm not creating or telling stories, yeah, which is what I'm really supposed to be doing. So it's hard to find that balance. So I figure once it gets easy enough, I'll play around with the mixed reality. But for now, I'm probably just going to paint my walls something cute, and just live stream, and mostly just show. It's not great, but shoot whatever I see until it's more feasible for me to spend time on that. But maybe in a few months when somebody figures that out in an easier way. But HoloLens. So I'm probably going to be doing some HoloLens stuff too. You've probably seen me messing around on Twitter. That's from Snapchat, where we just stick HoloLens on random strangers and just see how they respond. But I'll probably shoot some videos where you can actually see what I see in HoloLens, and I'll shoot some Let's Plays basically, and start playing around with that on my second channel.
Sweet.
Cool.
Getting into the AR.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Questions.
I do.
Dead Ed, what's up?
Okay. What was some of your biggest hurdles when branding yourself as a storyteller and entertainer?
When exactly? You mean
what were some of your biggest hurdles as branding yourself as a storyteller and entertainer? That's what I mean.
Just, I think you've been doing this 10 years or something, so any of that.
Yeah, so I guess that's why the timeline's a little tough. I went to film school long ago. I've been making films since I was in high school, basically. But I would say I never really branded until YouTube. And even then, you know, I didn't start branding or even understand that until I got into the YouTube Space LA program. That's probably when I got started on that. So, but what was cool is YouTube helped with that, because they felt it was their job to kind of really set people up for success. So part of Geek Lab was they said, we're going to set you up with a graphic designer, and you're going to sit down and decide the look, the color, what you want, and he's going to make you a banner. He's going to make you that little, the end slate, you know, that end, that thing at the end that had a little subscribe and the little images. And I used that for the longest time. So that guy helped a lot, because I didn't even understand how to use After Effects until I met that guy. So that was the beginning. And in terms of entertainer, I would say it took a year or two playing around on YouTube, once I got into YouTube Space LA, to learn that lesson that I was told, which was that I need to be the brand, not just Kill9 TV, and to get comfortable with that. So one of the things I did was I learned to put myself, which felt weird, but to put myself on the main page as kind of the face of it. I took a lot from Freddie Wong. I really like Freddie Wong's stuff from Rocket Jump, and, you know, he's always been the face.
Oh, yeah, he's awesome.
Yeah, he's great. And I thought, well, you know, I don't look at him and think he's full of himself, so it can't be that bad to be the face of my company if I'm proud of what I'm doing. So I would like to do some rebranding. It's just hard to get around to it, but I know that's what you do, so we should talk.
Oh, wow, okay, yeah.
She was at the meetup. It was a great meetup this last Sunday, yeah.
Yeah.
I got one for you,
Campfire.
Michelle.
Yeah.
Since you're out of the LA office, do you know the Funhouse guys?
Yeah. Is that Christina Heller? The Funhouse guys? Oh no,
Adam,
you're
totally
talking about the Fun.
House.
No, you're talking about the sorry, you're talking
Adam
about the YouTubers.
Adam Kovic. Yeah, YouTubers.
Yeah,
Adam Kovic and all that.
Yeah, I don't think I know them. I might have met them at some parties or something, but I don't.
I was
know
gonna say.
If I know them.
A few of them are really into the VR stuff. They even have a Vive. They do a couple videos a couple times a weekend. So they might be into your meetup thing.
Yeah, Yeah, that's a good, thanks for the heads up. I didn't even think of that. I should probably, once I solidify this date, because I know that they're looking at hitting up YouTubers who want to learn about VR, but I should also look at YouTubers who are already into VR, because maybe they'd want to come talk or demo something. And I did see their video. I saw their video when they did
the Pictionary.
Telltale Brush Pictionary. And some of those were pretty good, and some were so bad. It was so funny.
I mean, how do you draw cartography, really?
That was amazing. Try to draw cartography. That's a tough one.
That's awesome.
Any other questions?
More questions? Before we end the talk here. Going once, going twice. All right. Michelle, tell us where to go on the internet, where to find yourself. I have your Twitter up here on the web panels if you're able to see them. Sometimes they break. Michelle Kenobi, at Michelle Kenobi on Twitter. But what else? What do you want to point people to?
The easiest thing is probably to go to michelleosorio.com, because there you can get a link to everywhere that I'm at.
Yep.
But I would say please like me on Facebook, because that is the hardest place to get people. They always says, oh, pay $5 to boost your post. I pay $5 and nothing happens. So I just don't do it anymore. It's just so hard to promote Facebook. So if you look up Michelle Osorio of Kill9TV, or if you just put Michelle Osorio, it'll pop up. Please like me on Facebook. Nobody likes me. Not nobody, but I guess that needs the most help. I'm same thing. I'm Michelle Kenobi everywhere on Instagram, on Snapchat. Snapchat's the funnest, I would say, because I snap a lot. I would say if you want to be entertained, follow me on Snapchat, because I'm always filming my hijinks. Not always VR related. A lot of it is VR related, but sometimes I'm just, I don't know, like kicking a heavy bag at the gym or filming cats pooping. I promise that there's not a lot of cats pooping videos, so.
They're all fun.
Just
They're all
enough.
Definitely entertaining.
Just enough. And I sing a lot. I like to make up songs, so I do that a lot. Especially about VR, not always about VR, but I tend to sing songs about VR a lot.
Do you have your ukulele near you?
I do, yeah.
All right, so I'm going to finish what you were saying, because I interrupted you, and then I'll ask you to play the ukulele.
Sure. I was just going to say I'm Michelle Kenobi on Oculus and Steam VR as well.
Oh, yeah.
So
sweet.
If you add me, I will, or you send a request, I will add you.
And we'll play games?
And we can play games.
Yay. Yeah, I'm Gunter on there, so.
Oh, we're not even
playing
friends.
Games, people. There's so many networks. It's just so many Slack groups, so many Skypes, this, and so many Twitter lists and Facebook groups, and where am I? I don't even know anymore. Bob, what's going on with Left Handed VR Podcast? So we're gonna do a couple more plugs over here, and then I'd love for you to play us a song. But yeah.
Sure. Yeah, we actually recorded on Saturday. It was Jason, Reverend Kyle, and I. And
nice.
So I haven't actually been home to edit it, so I'm going to do that tomorrow and post that up. And then this Saturday, we've got a special podcast coming up, because we're going to be doing the VR Casters relaunch cast. So look for that soon.
What's VR Casters, Bob?
VR Casters is 24/7 VR podcast. From Left-Handed VR Podcast.
VR Casters!
Yep. Got Left-Handed VR Podcast.
We have a fan.
Kent Buys. We got Chris Miranda's Enter VR. We got Pod VR. Of course, we got the ITRL guys. And us, Left-Handed VR Podcast.
Awesome. Cool, you just turn it on. That's awesome. VR talk happening 24/7.
Yep. So that's going to be relaunching soon, probably sometime next week. But you know, you'll be seeing that on Twitter and everything. So you'll be able to check it out soon. And you can follow me at Cause and Effects pretty much everywhere.
And for me, just there's all kinds of events happening in VR chat, something every single night. To highlight, for me, it was last Saturday's karaoke night. Man, I was there for like 6 hours.
Wow.
You should definitely come check that out, and especially you, Michelle, because you're such a great singer. And even if you don't sing great, because most of us don't, but it's a blast. I certainly do not. VR Pill does come out to hear VR Pill, and if Michelle shows up to hear her, it's great fun stuff. And of course, our meetups on Sunday, come out to those. You can find all this information on our subreddit, reddit.com/r/VRChat. And there's links to the events there, and on the side, there's also a link to our Slack group. That is Skype, but better, and it's really easy to get hooked into. Just click the link there, and we'll get you in that group. If you want to learn about Unity, it's a good group to be in, because a lot of people there are just learning, and they're bringing what they learn from Unity into VR chat. You could do the same. And then follow me at Gunter's Universe. And also go to GuntersUniverse.com and sign up for my newsletter. So when I post, like, hey, there's a show today and this awesome person's on, you'll get an email that lets you know. And for those that really love me a lot or want to support the show, I have a Patreon. That's at patreon.com/Gunter. And links for all this is at Gunter's Universe.
Yeah.
And I got a big thanks to the Patreons that support me every single week. Some of them give a quarter a week. Some of them give a dollar a week. Some people give $5 a week. And I'm so appreciative for all of those. I know. Yep. And I also support people on Patreon, too. I love Patreon. It's a great place.
Yeah.
They're not a sponsor. I wish they were a sponsor. actually, I need sponsors. If anybody's looking to become a sponsor, I'd like to look into that. So, but anyways, I want to thank everybody for coming out. It's been a great show. I want to thank Michelle and Bob for being up here at the table. Michelle, you've been a wonderful guest. I want to thank everybody in the audience. Yeah, so many people. And Michelle's going to take us out with a little song called I'm Not Sure. She'll tell us what the name of it is on her ukulele.
And I forgot to mention I have a Patreon, too. So it's mostly to support that second channel where I'm starting to try out new VR experiences and filming my adventures, going to Oculus, going to Facebook, going to GDC.
Yeah, you're all over the place.
Yeah.
Fly everywhere. It's so cool.
Okay, so I don't know a lot of songs on ukulele, so this is the same one I sang at Altspace, so I'm not very original. I'm sorry. But this is called...
First time I'm hearing
it. Okay, good. This one's called Someone to Lava.
Yeah.
From that Pixar short film. I don't remember which film it was from, but it's just a really sweet song. I have to read the lyrics off the computer screen, so I'm going to look a little weird, like I'm looking up.
No problemo. That's what we do here. I'll make myself look weird, too. Just
Aw, thank you. I appreciate that.
We should all do that.
I can't.
Okay.
Oh,
nice.
Hell yeah.
That was right.
Oh.
Oh, you sat down. Nope.
Oh, no. Wait, hold on.
See? We all look funny together.
VR Pilking thing called Trick Club now.
I'm just very curious what Pill's trying to do right now.
Oh, jeez.
Huh? Did I sit down?
I tried to take the microphone, but...
We love VR Pill!
Can I... Oh, are you just holding it up? Or am
I'm holding it. You have to sing. Grab my hand and...
You can't grab it, no. He's teasing, but...
That's okay. You can hold it up for me. Alright, so let me just... I'm going to look...
Pill's the mic stand.
I'm going to take a picture.
Right, look weird. I look weird.
Yes. Don't worry. It's okay.
Okay.
Everybody's coming closer, so why don't we do that? Everybody who wants to come down around the table area, come on down.
Anybody hear me?
Shh. Yeah, one moment.
I'm just tuning.
Oh. The mic situation could be a little better because it's kind of like that little click. Don't worry about it though, Michelle.
Is it okay?
Yeah, while she's tuning 10,000 polygons, we do hear you. I'm glad to see you, buddy. Or Kelly. Whoops, couldn't tell who it was. Glad to see both.
It's polygons.
Yeah. Hey, okay. Wait, watch it there. Oh.
Alright. A long, long time ago. Whoops. This is gonna be hard. There was a volcano living all alone in the middle of the sea. He sat high above his bay, watching all the couples play, wishing that he had someone to help him. And from his lava came this song of hope that he sang out loud every day for years and years. I have a dream I hope will come true, that you're here with me and I'm here with you. I wish that the earth, sea, and sky up above will send me someone to love. He was singing all along, turned his lover into stone until he was on the brink of extinction. But little did he know that living is below, another volcano was listening to his song. Okay, hang on, my vibe is like falling down. Every day she heard his tune, her lava grew and grew because she believed his song was meant for her. Now she was so ready to meet him above the sea as he sang a song of hope for the last time. I have a dream I hope will come true, that you're here with me and I'm here with you. I wish that the earth, sea, and sky up above will send me someone to love us. I have to keep adjusting. One moment.
Woohoo! It's not over. Not over.
It's not over! Don't you want to know what happens to the volcano?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh my god,
rising,
do I ever.
Rising from the sea below, stood a lovely volcano looking all around, but she could not see him. He tried to sing to let her know that she was not alone, but with no love, song was all done. He filled the sea with his dreams, watching his dreams disappear as she remembered what song meant to her. He filled the sea with his tears. Roll, hang on. No, I already saw that part. Sang that part. Yeah. And oh, they were so happy to finally meet above the sea. And all together now their lava grew and grew. No longer were they all alone with Hawaii as their new home. And when you visit them, this is what they see. I have a dream I hope will come true, that you're here with me and I'm here with you. I wish that the earth, sea, and sky above would send me someone.
Yay!
Yay. 5 pounds.